Okay, welcome everybody. It's my great pleasure to be here and have so many of you viewing. I want you to get your questions queued up because there's going to be plenty of time for that at the end. This is my conflict of interest slide that many of you may recognize. And today we're talking about improving the accuracy of genome sequencing and interpretation. So we're going to go through the kind of cohort that you can use to go that has an apparent contradiction of have an n equal 1 cohort, but nevertheless having really big data, having large amounts of data about individuals, and how you can move from correlation to causation and therapies. And we're going to talk about a new sequencing technology that allows one to do everything that you can do with current sequencing, plus an in situ approach. And then finally, talk about this causality in the context of testing hypotheses that can be done on a patient-specific individual basis. So as you all know, the cost of pharmaceutical research and development has been rising for a long time now, at least since the 90s. But the good news is that other aspects of biotechnology have been dropping much more rapidly than that, and provide us with hope that will change the overall cost of healthcare impacted by reading and writing biological components. Here's an example of a curve that was a bit surprising. We were already surprised that DNA reading and writing was following the exponential curve similar to electronics and telecommunications, which is about a 1.5-fold per year. But there still remained, at that rate, how long would it take to get from a $3 billion genome, which was unacceptable, to something in the $1 to $3,000 range. And the estimate from Moore's Law, this 1.5-fold per year, would be 6 decades. Fortunately, instead of 6 decades, it was only 6 years. And now it's hovering somewhere around $2,000 to $4,000 per whole genome, and a little bit less than that or exomes. So this kind of drop in price is expected in other aspects of genomics and is continuing for sequencing, and as we'll see in a moment. Now, along with that comes quality improvements, and we can see certain resources in our community that reflect this and potential further improvements that we can make. So there's projects like the Thousand Genomes Project and dbGaP and this whole set of acronyms here that focused on NIH and the Allen Brain Institute. And what can we do to improve the quality, not just of the raw data, but of the interpretation? And one of the things that we can do is we can not only get the raw genome sequence, but we can get the haplotype and diplotype, meaning the exact series of sequence variations that occur along each of your chromosomes. And we can get traits and environmental data, which we're missing from a lot of the databases up until recently. And we can, when we're looking at epigenetic effects, we can get either pure cells by new methods or assess them in situ with all the power of RNA sequencing plus all the power of in situ. And so we'll go through these during this talk. Now, in projects like the Personal Genome Project, we have not just the genome sequence, we also have trait data. We not only have the trait data and genome sequence, we have all these intermediates, that is to say the environmental components which influence the epigenome. So we don't need to guess how we go from genome to trait with predictive algorithms. We can add additional data. We get a big data set around each person. And this is epitomized by the Personal Genome Project, and it is still the world's only open access data source for this kind of precision medicine, and it's international now in a number of countries. And in it, we can get a preview of how precision medicine can incorporate such things as the immune system response to the microbial complexity and to chemicals and nutritional components of your environment. And then we can test hypotheses using stem cells as well. Now, this process is reflected in IRB and LREC and REB approval in various countries, which allows us to get hundreds of thousands of individuals per nation. These individuals can be kept quite secure, or they can be made public. We have the full range of choice. Point is, the individuals are in charge of their own data, and they can get access to their own data and interpretations for it. So this is all about genomes, environments, and traits. And by traits, we mean this in a very broad sense, try to be inclusive. This includes establishing stem cell biobanks and many differentiated derivatives. We have new technology for that. Traits all the way up to the whole organism trait that are uniquely human, including behavioral, cognitive, and magnetic resonance imaging. And the reason we can make this rich data set available internationally without concerns is that each individual has to get 100% on an entrance exam, so that they know what they're getting into. They know that all medical research has a very high chance of data escape and a high chance of re-identification of an individual, not just from genomic data, but from a whole variety of identifying medical information like MRI, photographs, or just rich trait data sets. This protocol, this personal genome type of protocol, which allows for either secure or open, but in all cases, well-informed consent, has been recognized now by the NIH, the ENCODE program, as well as the NCBI, and in this case, in this slide, the NIST and FDA, National Institute of Standards and Technology, and the Food and Drug Administration, have teamed up to establish genome standards. And after a worldwide search for appropriately consented genomes, found so far only the Personal Genome Project, and they're starting with 8 trios of 24 individuals. Thousands of these will be made available worldwide. Now, we have cohorts like this that we can share and help us improve our interpretation quality. And we have providers that are working real time to keep up with these improvements in sequencing quality and interpretation quality. We can get carrier testing, which is one of the most important. There's a lot of emphasis on cancer and pharmacogenomics, but I think sometimes we forget that carrier testing is one of the really key ways of doing preventative medicine, and can be practiced at a very, very early stage, premarital preconception. Now, in terms of the accuracy of the raw sequencing data, something that is rarely discussed and offered, but is of great clinical and even research significance, is this idea of haplotyping and diplotyping, knowing exactly which alleles are present on one chromosome. And so you can imagine a scenario, for example, where C is a deleterious allele and G is an acceptable allele, and you can have two scenarios. One is if you have two deleterious alleles in one gene, do they occur in cis? That is to say, you have one good copy and one doubly bad copy, or you could be in trans where you have two bad copies. And this is like night and day. This is the difference between one good gene versus zero good genes, and that means you can see the clinical implications of that. The first example of this was published in Nature about a year ago, and it was established, this is a collaboration with Complete Genomics and our group, where 10 cells were used, distributed over a 384-well plate, kind of stylized in the lower right. And by just distributing those 10 cells, you get a dilution effect, and you get hundreds of kilobases of fragments, which you can sequence by whole genome amplification and whatever next-generation sequencing. That has the side advantage of by separating out repeats and paralogs and homologs and it reduces the error rates down to about 1 in 10 to the 7th. So 1 in 10 million rather than a more conventional, which is 1 in 100,000. So this is really quite a big improvement. It tells you the difference between one good gene and zero, and it gives you very high accuracy. Now, this was done with 10 cells, not as a stunt to show that you can do it with a small number of cells, but it's an intrinsic advantage of the intrinsic part of the protocol. Now, but you could, that's 10 cells just out of convenience and protocol, but you could go for a small number of cells as a valuable technical goal, where you have a very small number of cells, or each cell is slightly different in an epigenetic sense. And so then you get into the genomics of single cells. But even more significant, once you get down to single cells and you're looking at transcripts and other things that are epigenetic rather than genetic, you can get deviation from cell to cell, two adjacent cells that look similar, whether it's in a cancer, a pathological cellular sample that's not cancer, or a variety of developmental stages. And so really, it's not single cell, it's subcellular and multicellular. So the whole context, the whole geometry, the morphology of adjacent cells is significant. And you want to do this not in the one-dimensional GATCs or even a two-dimensional. You want a full three-dimensional image of your pathological specimen or your serial sections. And furthermore, you don't want to be limited to one color or even four colors, which is typical of microscopy and fluorescence microscopy. You'd like to have as many colors as possible. And one way of looking at next-generation sequencing is that it gives you access to on the order of 4 to the n colors, where n is the number of cycles, the number of iterations of sequencing. So how do we do this? How do we get to subcellular resolution on millions of cells simultaneously on a glass slide and three dimensions? And you can think of almost every tissue is complex. There's very few that what you would consider homogeneous. Even something as simple as skin has 57 some cell types, possibly more, in as little as a cubic millimeter, including all sorts of immune and nerve components. And by either serial sectioning or thick sections, you can get access to a three-dimensional section view of this. And we have developed, a postdoctoral fellow Jay Lee and Evan Doherty and others in the slide, have developed methods over the last decade that are just now submitted for publication that allow us to cross-link this tissue and clarify it so it's clear to three-dimensional microscopy, and then do a very light amount of amplification, again, cross-linking all the amplification products into a tissue slice, and then go in and do next-generation sequencing, either sequencing by synthesis, like as in Illumina, or sequencing by ligation, as occurs in complete genomics or in solid. And we've done this now, and I'll give some examples of how we do how this works. Now, one of the things that comes up is that the cell is very dense in RNA molecules, and we would like to be able to sample not just the poly-A adjacent sites or sample a few chosen transcripts, which would bias the assay. We'd really like to do the kind of total RNA analysis that you get from RNA-seq. And so with that level of crowding, you have three options for at least for handling this. One is super resolution microscopy. I'll show that briefly, how we can improve from sort of typical 400 nanometer, or actually quite exceptional 400 nanometer, to as little as 10 nanometer resolution. And then molecular stratification, where we're looking at subsets at a time, but cumulatively sampling the entire transcriptome. And then finally, deconvolution methods. So here's an example of a paper co-authored with Peng Yin's group in Nature Chemistry recently, where we made DNA nanostructures that had barcodes sort of in 42 nanometer spacing and 10 nanometer resolution. We had, this is the molecular stratification, where you can see the cDNAs can be probed with primers that have they can be random primers, but at the end is a particular non-random base followed by a second base and a third and so forth. So if you have a poly A end or some other way of stratifying, you can say, I will only take the subset of messenger RNAs that have this base or two bases or three bases. And one base will give you a fourfold stratification, and two will give you 16, and three will give you 64. And so we've used this, and this can be used in combination with the other two methods. And here's deconvolution, which is mainly computational, and you can see that you can get really a huge improvement in resolution on the order of tenfold improvement in quality. And the way we assess quality is based on intensity comparisons, overlapping of the colors, and the final, of course, is the read placement quality. We can get up to 97% placed on the correct strand in a database, where random placement would be represented by 50% on the synth strand. So we've talked about the PGP as an open cohort, and of course many other implications of that, having big data. One particular new form of big data and new form of accurate DNA sequencing is this FISSEQ procedure, and we also mentioned the complete genomics LFR, where you can get haplotyping and diplotyping. Now we need to go on to test the hypotheses that come from interpretation. How is it that we develop software that's vetted for interpretation and can test it with engineering? So we have here examples of identified individuals who have shared their story with the public. Many of you will probably recognize some of these, like Nick Volker, who had intestinal surgeries and then was treated with cord blood and has been cured now for years. Beery twins who had been misdiagnosed for cerebral palsy and getting their genome or exome sequenced, as was Nick Volker, discovered that they could have orally available chemicals, precursors for serotonin and dopamine, which would alleviate nearly all of their symptoms. We have many examples of what you do when you have a cancer predisposition or a cancer that has a particular personal component that might be new. John Lauerman was one of the Personal Genome Project volunteers who presented as healthy but with previous symptoms such as leg pain and retinal scotomas, little dark spots. This was thought by his physicians it could be somehow due to clotting, and so one gene test was done, which was factor V Leiden. That test was negative, but when we went on and did the whole genome, not just the exome, but the entire genome, we found that it was not, that we confirmed the negative for the factor V Leiden, but had a positive for JAK2, which had not been tested. And this illustrates the problem with doing kind of guessing at individual genes rather than looking at the whole genome. Now, so those are examples of people with rare deleterious alleles. Here's a small cohort that I particularly enjoy, which is where we're looking not for rare deleterious alleles, but rare alleles that are highly protective. And we'll give some examples of that and how we can move on to causality. We don't know yet. We're going to see probably hundreds of centenarians, and many of those will be supercentenarians, meaning over 110 years old. In the next year or two, sequences will be publicly available, and we hope to find some patterns of protective alleles that we can study and help us, inspire us to develop therapies, whether the gene therapies or other types of therapies. And the take home from this slide is not that in order to survive past 110, you should drink and smoke to excess and eat sweets, which they also like to do. The idea is that perhaps their environment is, like ours, less than optimal, but they have protective alleles. We won't know for a year or two, but here's some examples of some protective alleles that give us the idea and how one follows up on it. Here are two individuals, close to the only two individuals in the world that have two different genes affected in the same pathway. This is the myostatin pathway. One is a myostatin mutant double null, and the other is a myostatin receptor. And the consequence of this for humans is thought to be enhanced muscle growth from birth. And to confirm this hypothesis, because we don't have large cohorts, this is just one of each, N equals one of the myostatin and one of the receptor. One way to prove causality is animal models. And in this case, we have the rare instance of having three animal models, cows, dogs, and mice, where the myostatin null is on the right. So this is one approach to moving from correlation to causality, partly required in this case because there's so few individuals in the world that are myostatin null. But here's some other examples of rare protective alleles that we can that I submit for your consideration. In addition to myostatin, there's variations on LRP. These are heterozygotes, which have extra strong bones. They extremely strong, dense, sometimes as many as 8 standard deviations from the mean. PCSK9 has inspired the drug industry to develop a series of inhibitors of this pathway because there are people that are nearly completely absent in this and have extremely low LDL cholesterol, and they also have very low coronary artery disease and apparently no significant negative effects of being nearly null in PCSK9. CCR5 and FUT2 are interesting, maybe of a class of viral receptors which can be deleted without a gigantic effect on the phenotype. We'll come back to CCR5 in a moment. FUT2 is a norovirus resistance affecting the equivalent of the ABO blood groups in the gastrointestinal system. Finally, APP could be on another list, which is a list of rare deleterious alleles that will advance your Alzheimer's. But it's on this list because there are rare APP alleles that give you an extra 15 years, reduce the probability and extend the number of years without Alzheimer's. So how do we take these rare protective alleles and apply them to the general population, which is the common but deleterious alleles? And by very common, they could be 99.9% of us. So here's an example. It was inspired by the Timothy Ray Brown, who had both leukemia and AIDS, unfortunately, in 2007. Treatment for leukemia involved getting a match for his HLA loci, a tissue-compatible donor. And in this case, they happened to find one who was not only matched for HLA, but also happened to be a CCR5 double null. And the CCR5 is the receptor for the AIDS virus. And so he was cured of both leukemia and AIDS and is, I think, healthy and drug-free, as far as I know. And then this inspired Sangamo and others to develop a way of doing this intentionally, not just waiting for a histocompatible donor, but developing a method by which you could take cells out of any AIDS patient's body, delete both copies of the gene for CCR5, and then put the cells back in. Now, many of the T cells that are produced are double nulls, that is to say they make no CCR5, and hence they're not susceptible to the HIV infection, which requires CCR5 membrane protein as a co-receptor. So this is, Sangamo does this by a zinc finger nuclease approach, which has a total of 8 fingers recognizing roughly about 3 base pairs each, and coupled in the middle by a bacterial nuclease dimer. This is one of now, that used to be the only game in town for precise deletion or homologous recombination that's efficient. Now there are many ways. There are meganucleases not shown, zinc finger nucleases, the talons, and the latest, of course, of these is CRISPR, which we and others just started publishing on in January. This is the first instances, and this was done in human cells, and now has been extended to many other plant and animal genomes. And the difference here between all the previous ones, the meganucleases, the zinc fingers, and the talons, those were all proteins that would have to be heavily crafted and were bulky and large in order to recognize enough base pairs to have specificity. While the Cas9 CRISPR is not using protein to recognize double-strand DNA, but RNA to recognize one of the two strands, and the RNA is on the order of 20 bases, of which 12 are quite significant, and then another 2 base pairs or so that are recognized by the protein itself. So the Cas9 protein, the guide RNA, and the double-stranded genomic DNA make a complex which can be adequately specific for both testing hypotheses in genomics as well as gene therapy in the future. And this shows this kind of the history of this. It started in 1987 when the first CRISPRs were found. They looked like junk DNA, repetitive DNA in bacterial genomes, exactly the sort of thing that people didn't want to spend genome money on, but this turned out to be extremely valuable. And then since January 2013, we've seen all of these and many more articles coming out on all these different organisms, mouse, zebrafish, Drosophila, Rhabdopsis, C. elegans, yeast, and so on. Now, so this in our group started with the work of Luhan Yang, who will be defending her PhD tomorrow, and postdoc Prashant Mali, and others at Berkeley and the Broad Institute and Harvard and so forth. And we started out with comparing directly talons and 2 different guide RNAs that could be multiplexed and all aiming at the same region of a tester gene, and found about a 9 to 22 fold improvement in efficiency over the talons, and a gigantic improvement, maybe hundreds of fold easier ease of programming. So we basically only have to make 20 base pairs that's new for each construct, and this allows us to make multiple constructs, tens of thousands of them at low cost, and this high efficiency that you see, 9 to 22 fold relative to a talon aimed at exactly the same point in the genome and the chromatin. And now since then, there's been kind of an explosion of kind of Cambrian explosion, this is a CRISPRian explosion of different things that you can do. You can not only make that double strand break, which is the way it comes from the wild, for it comes from bacterial defense mechanisms making double strand breaks. You can knock out one of the 2 nicking components and now making a nicking enzyme. Instead of making double strand break, you just nick on one strand, and that's quite useful. Or you can knock out both nuclease functions, and now you have something that just binds without nicking, and that can be used to deliver effectors that modify the chromatin to either inhibit or activate, or you can bring together different parts of the chromosome. And these effectors can be attached either to the protein Cas9 component or to the guide RNA component. So you can get lots of different combinations. And this is work from Prashant Mali and Kevin Esvelt. So We want to improve specificity. All of the methods that I've mentioned, the negative nucleus, the zinc fingers, and the taus, and the CRISPRs all have some off target. This is usually tolerable for a variety of reasons, but there are ways that you can improve it. So you can computationally look for matches. You can find, for a given gene, you have many choices. You can pick the ones that have the fewest off target computationally. Then you can take a subset of those that have the least off target empirically by actually testing them in human cells. You can use NICs, which rather than double strand breaks, the NICs make a strong preference for homologous recombination over non-homologous enjoining. And non-homologous enjoining is basically where you have a double strand break, you bash them together and either insert or delete or some combination, a few base pairs. You can require two or more sites for either the cleavage or the activation modalities. This paper just published last week. So that two or more sites for cleavage or multiple sites for activation. Here's an example of that multiple sites for activation, where you know, on the far left-hand side, you can see the kind of the very low level of change that you can get. You can engineer with just having one site. So that means if you have one of these off target, it's also going to be low, very low or undetectable. But if you put several of them in a row, and sort of in this window of minus 2 to minus 0.8 kb, you can now see very significant 100-fold increase in activation and very low probability that you would have these same cluster of sites off target. Now, in our first paper, we made available 190,000 different guide RNA sites derived computationally, and we synthesize 10,000 at a time. And these can be synthesized by four basic methods, either inkjet or light-directed methods. And we've tended to use the custom array or the Agilent, but the microarray and the Roche Nimblegen are also available. And there are various ways that you can improve. You can do error correction on these in bulk, and you can make literally millions of these 20 mers that provide guide RNAs. Now, the informatics on this has been greatly aided by work of John Ock, and this is available on this website, arep.med.harvard.edu/human-crispr. And the 190,000 that we have so far, and this number will go up, covers about 90% of all genes and 40% of the exons in those genes. So it's getting very close to complete. We're focusing now specifically on DNA and RNA binding proteins, the long RNAs and the microRNAs, so that we can either crank them up in level or crank them all the way down to zero, which is hard to do with the siRNAs or short hairpin RNAs, but is quite feasible to do with a double null from CRISPR. So you can think of this as all the advantages of homologous recombination methods, and plus the efficiency and the ease of use of the short hairpin libraries. Now, with this, we now have a newfound ability to do epigenetic programming, and it's not just going from skin fibroblasts to iPS to something else. You can, we and many others are exploring going from any cell to any cell, the kind of multipotency, going from mitotic cells that are capable of replication, not necessarily pluripotent stem cells, but any replicating cell, to a non-replicating or post mitotic cell. And so, for example, going from a fibroblast to iPS to a neuron is something we'll explore in just a moment here. And so here's an example of a protocol where we can go with over 98% efficiency, meaning 98% conservation of the stem cells. which are this highly clumped, dense small cells that are at day zero on the left-hand side, to within 4 days, this nearly quantitative 98% conversion to these very distinct morphology of cells that are bipolar with exactly two processes coming out, and by a change of the gene that we introduce here, neurogenin 1 or 2 or both, will produce these bipolar cells. By changing that protocol, we can get tripolar processes coming out, all very predictable and rapid, and in a way skipping many steps that might occur during normal development. We've done RNA sequencing, and we're going on to do many epigenetic profiling of these various cell types that you can get in pure populations from by transdifferentiation, and using specific cDNAs or CRISPR up or down regulation or cleavage. Now, so what we've talked about is ways of getting a highly accurate sequence, from, including haplotype and diplotype, where you really know whether you have zero or one functional genes, if you have two mutations in one gene, and how this, how the entire constellation of genetic information can be correlated with big data that includes environments and trait data, very comprehensive omics data, and 724 physiological monitoring, and MRI imaging, and so forth. How you can correlate this with developmental, pathological, or cancer in situ analysis, and then finally how you can find rare protective alleles as well as rare deleterious ones, and how you can inspect and confirm specific hypotheses, and then turn those hypotheses from correlative into causal, and then into therapies using the CRISPR technology. So I'm going to open it up for questions now, and hopefully, and we'll leave the slide up for a moment. The thank yous we have for personalgenomes.org and pged.org that provide free data to the world, no charge to the participants nor to anyone using it, no strings attached. They're consented for commercial use. And the effort is to get education far beyond this sort of high-level education we're talking about today, but all the way down into high schools and so on. So thanks to all of them and to you. So opening up for questions. Yeah. So, okay, so I've just been reading through some of the Q&A questions that are online, and sorry for the slight delay here. So the first question is, does the accuracy of genetic sequence depend on cultural and linguistic differences, which is beyond the environmental barrier? I'm not exactly sure what the intention here, but the project is multicultural and linguistic. We're trying to establish outposts in multiple countries that adapt the Personal Genome Project consenting mechanism to the local culture laws and languages. The sequence itself, though, is as far as we know, universal. A question here about the feasibility of epigenetic reprogramming of cells in situ, specifically neuronal cells. I think this is early days. There are some evidences of both epigenetic and recombinational methods for working with post-mitotic neuronal cells. Certainly, they are their epigenetic state, their transcriptional state, is modified in the process of normal memory and neuronal function. So, I think that's early. The recently released light paper was really amazing. Has or will the algorithm for LFR haplotyping be extended to resolve polyploidy in non-model organisms such as plants or enhanced de novo assemblies? I think those are two separate topics. I didn't talk about the light paper, but that's referring to light modulated epigenetics. I refer you to the Nature paper we did in collaboration with the Zhang lab at Broad Institute. The LFR is restricted to humans right now in the complete genomics, but the variations on it should certainly work in other organisms, and it is not dependent upon diploid state. It should be especially valuable for getting these long haplotypes that will allow polyploid discrimination, which was the question. Will genome sequencing replace PCR for diagnostic testing eventually? I think a lot of genome sequencing includes some sort of amplification process, so it's not really replacing it, it's augmenting it. I guess the question is, will genome sequencing become so inexpensive and accurate, or will the demand for comprehensive and accuracy outweigh very simple tests like PCR or even chip assays? I think it's looking that way. It's looking, if you follow the trend, but until a whole genome sequence is sort of in the couple hundred dollar range, people will still be looking for bargains. But I think it's already a bargain at where it is right now if you consider it amortized over a lifetime. But there are many other things that you want to do more frequently than once in a lifetime, which include microbiomics, immunological. There's a question, George, do you think the next major breakthrough in genome sequencing technology will be nanopore-based or something else? I think we're going to see this fall, handheld, sort of hand-sized device that will be not nanopore, be closer to sort of the ion torrent, but from Genapsys. I think that's something to watch out for this fall. Nanopore, maybe in the next year or two, we're already seeing some interesting raw data accuracy from the Genia Columbia collaboration. Keep your eye out for that. It's very exciting that this technology is not so stable. Question about cost implications for importing to therapeutic usage. I mean, clearly for therapeutic, you need high quality, you need assurance that will cost a little bit at first, but it will create much larger markets, which will drive down the prices possibly even faster than they are right now. Hard to say, but I think the cost implications for combining diagnostics and therapeutics in various ways is quite exciting, but no guarantees or promises. Question about assessment and quality control done during the steps in trans differentiation. So we and others, in particular Kun Zhang's group at UCSD, have monitored for genomic changes during trans differentiation and has found that there's some potential stress-induced mutations, also just some mutations that inevitably come from replication that you find in going from fibroblast to iPS cells. And I think this is still an active research problem, both documenting when transdifferentiation causes mutations, why, and how to prevent it. These are all interesting questions, and whether it's true for other transdifferentiation events that have been less well studied. So one kind of QC that was done in that case was exome sequencing or whole genome sequencing. If you have particular loci, you could do more targeted sequencing, although that's not particularly cost effective at this point. Other QC, you could do epigenetic QC to make sure that the RNAs that are expressed are similar to the RNAs that you intended by the transdifferentiation process. All these QCs are now much more feasible because of the million-fold decrease in the cost of sequencing. You wouldn't have considered that as a QC method even a few years ago. The variability and analysis tools will impact interpretation of data. Does the personalgenomes.org plan provide guidance on analysis tools used? You know, we're like Wikipedia. We want to be inclusive of and present the best possible interpretation. We provide get evidence freely, open source software that does genome interpretation. We provide that in part because we know that since our genomes are freely available, they will be interpreted by somebody. We want to at least have one of the interpretation software suites be something that we can collectively inspect and approve or modify as a community. So we want to be able to track who made the changes, who made the suggestions, give them credit, as well as make sure that they're making good suggestions. And so if it's too proprietary, it makes it hard to critique and assess. And so we have at least this option of the get evidence. So that was a good question. Thank you for asking that. We've still got a lot of questions here. Is the question here is about variability of DNA sequence within a single individual due to mosaicism and somatic mutations. I mentioned briefly the kind of mutations that can occur during transdifferentiation in laboratory, but you can also, we expect and find somatic mutations even in diseases that are very mildly proliferative, like the JAK2 mutation I mentioned, the PGP volunteer John Lauerman, but we expect and find somatic mutations that, as far as we know, are not proliferative. The question is, what will, are some of these neutral? You'll tend to find the ones that are proliferative where he has a slight growth advantage, but not necessarily cancer, could be quite benign. Question about how long do we think it will take to get to $100? We're down right now around a little less than $1,000 cost, but close to $5,000 price for individual genomes. You can get down close to $1,000 as a bulk rate if you collectively bargain, as many are doing, including the Personal Genome Project. We're down sort of like just around $1,000. Down to a few hundred, it's plateaued for the last couple of years. I think it's going to take off again this year, and it'll probably down in the hundreds of dollars of this year or next. Can you describe the advantage of CRISPR in creating transgenic animal models, knockout models for studying disease? There's a lot of enthusiasm about using this on animals, not just as models for disease, but as, you know, humanization of animals for testing drugs, for transplants. Not only humanization, but personalized animal models for you know, for agricultural purposes. And Rudy Yenich had a lovely paper recently showing how you could introduce large numbers of changes simultaneously. So if you have to change six different positions in the genome simultaneously, that's the efficiency is compatible with that. And that, I urge you to take a look at the paper from Rudy's lab. There's a question of, does the $2,000 or $1,000 cost to $2,000 to $5,000 price include the cost of informatics and time spent on data interpretation? Now, some people think that the data interpretation is open-ended and can be hundreds of thousands of dollars. In practice, there are services and even instruments, you know, that will interpret for on the order of $400. You can always add more value to that in terms of you know, personal attention of a genetic counselor or medical genetics physician. But the core cost is probably on the order of $400 or less. And there are services that are free on the internet. But in the end, you need to be talking to physicians, and that is going to cost you at least what your annual the cost of annual checkups. And increasingly, this is being, these special tests are being reimbursed. There are many companies that now have figured out how to communicate with the reimbursing entities and are getting reimbursed for not just single gene tests, but whole genome as well. Question of whether affordable genome sequencing for the general population, when will that occur? I think we're already at that point. There's an odd disconnect between the cost effectiveness that you can get from a whole genome sequence, and you know how many different medical procedures cost more than that and could be saved. Morbidity and mortality saving over a lifetime. You amortize, you know, a $2,000 to $5,000 genome over a lifetime, and it's very little. I think the reason that there's this disconnect is there's this kind of this general feeling that since genetics can't predict everything, then it really you kind of extrapolate and say it can't predict anything. And the difference between everything and anything is gigantic. It predicts many things quite accurately, and then you can say, well, I'm not going to get it because only my family has any genetic disease that I know of. But it's very common for you to be the first one in your family. And so you don't really know whether it's beneficial to you or not until you've looked at your genome or had some software look at your genome. And the software doesn't have to report everything, just reports the things that are that you want to see that are, say, actionable and predictable above a certain level. I think a lot of people dismiss it. The same people would not, would go out and buy airbags in cars, even though they know that very few people ever get any benefit from airbags. And the same thing with the genome, even if they know lots of people who don't get benefit from the genome, it's still valuable because you might benefit from it, and the cost is on the order of the cost of airbags. There's a question as to whether CRISPR, and for that matter, other the DNA binding proteins that can cleave DNA, whether this specificity is due to annealing the RNA strands of the DNA to similar sequences or to other factors. It is to similar, typically is to similar sequences, whether it's protein DNA interaction or protein RNA DNA interaction that's doing the recognition. The main off targets are related in sequence, and you can reduce that very significantly by requiring two sites near one another. So the probability that you happen to have this site, which is pretty specific, right next to another off target, is vanishingly small. So that's the progress in specificity that we just published in Nature Biotechnology last week. Still lots and lots of questions. I'm trying to get all of them. How far is DNA methylation analysis from clinics and diagnostics? What would be what should be proved in methylation assessment to make it more relevant clinically? Yeah, I think methylation is certainly the methylome is separate from the genome. Genome is roughly the same in all cells in your body, while methylation varies tremendously from cell to cell. But methylation is related to other measures of the cell differentiation and pathology and environmental components, which includes RNA analysis, even protein analysis. These are all related to the identity of the cell type. And any of these could make it into the clinic. You know, I can imagine that something like in situ sequencing, answering this question, would be superior in a pathology clinic to just a typical stain or looking at one protein or another with antibodies, where you can get an overview of essentially all of the gene products. And so it doesn't have to be methylation, it could be RNA analysis, and we're going to see some pretty significant reconsideration of the options when the in situ sequencing gets published very soon. How trustworthy is tumor sequencing without matched controls? Or alternatively, what percentage of mutations we see in a tumor genome are private SNPs? Yes, so I think the general consensus is you need a normal control. Normal controls are actually much easier to get than the tumor itself. The problem with the normal control can be quite tumor-free, while the tumor is typically contaminated with normal cells. So that's actually a pretty easy control, very valuable. You might have 3 million SNPs which are private to you, differ between you and, other people. Maybe on the order of thousands that differ between your tumor and normal. So it's a much smaller set. Of course, it depends on how advanced the tumor is and so forth. So yes, definitely it's an important control, relatively easy one to do. Question is, how stable is personal genome? How often would you have your own genome done? I think your inherited genome is quite stable, but you might want to, if we develop methodology for doing monitoring of somatic cells, for example, circulating tumor cells, that would be an argument for doing your personal genome more than once. The overall genome in your body is stable, but those cancer cells, which are either circulating or locked away in the tissue, can be assessed if you can get access to them. Another genome is your microbial genome, both on the inside and the outside of your body. That should be monitored, and your immune response. So those are three genomes in your body that could be monitored quite frequently, and basically the more, the better. There's a question of who does the reimbursement. I'm not an expert on this, but my impression is that both health insurance and HMOs will provide reimbursement. But you should check with your physician on that. But it's on the order of 50%, depending on. Whether you have family history, whether you have symptoms, those sort of things greatly increase the probability you'll get reimbursed. There's a question about using personal genomics synergistically in the field of criminology. I think we have a adequate DNA identification with a small number of loci that are typically on the order of 13 loci, depending on the country, that are typically little repetitive sequences. But the opportunity is there for Those just tell you if you have an exact match in your database. But looking at things like the Y chromosome, you can establish surname, or looking at markers for visible traits like facial features, skin color, hair, texture, and so forth. Those are increasingly well understood and can be used. Question about asking for more details about immunological studies driven by next generation sequencing. For the immunology, we have two tools now. One is being able to characterize what your BNT cells, how they're responding, how clones are expanding, how diversity is reflected in new antigens, for example, coming from vaccines. We have studies on HIV non-responders and which antibodies are capable of neutralizing HIV. Even if vaccines don't work, there's a possibility that a rare individual, well, this is observed, that rare individuals can be have HIV neutralizing antibodies. And then so that's one broad class, is characterizing antibodies to particular pathogens or antigens. The other category is doing a profile where you can do a spectrum where you have a library of antigens that are barcoded, and then you can see whether a particular bodily fluid will be reactive to which antigen. So you can determine autoreactivity, autoimmunity, whether you have circulating antibodies to various viruses, virus subtypes, allergens, bacteria, and so on. Okay, so I think we're a little over time here, and I greatly appreciate all your enthusiasm and questions. I hope I got to everyone's. Some of them were asked more than once in different ways, and it really enjoyed being with you today, and hope to see you in the future. Thank you.